join us as we sing, "Sing to the King, and We Will Glorify"?
As God has shared his blessings with us, let us now share our blessings with God. prayer. Loving God, we come before you on a morning that has been carefully selected by Christians throughout the world to celebrate your Holy Communion, your gift to us, the body and blood of Christ, the reminders of the sacrifice that he made for us, but also the new deal that he provided for us. And we give you thanks that we can celebrate with Christians throughout the world this wonderful gift and our common faith. As we approach you this morning, we ask that you help us to remember why it is that we are here. We are here to celebrate you, to glorify you, to enjoy you. We are here to rejoice in the gift that Jesus has given us, and to take that gift to the world, to reveal Jesus alive and well, to bring mercy and kindness and love to those who are in need, to supply for the physical needs where we can, and to provide for spiritual concerns as well. We are here, God, to feel and to know your Holy Spirit, to receive its wisdom, to breathe in its life, to be empowered so that we can bring you to others. So we ask, God, that as we come here and as we gather, as we think about this meal and what it means to us, that you help us to do so with clean hearts and memories and minds free of shame. Forgive us for the sins that we have committed. Take away the guilt of shame. Take away all of those things in our own selves that cause us to sin. And help us by the power of the Holy Spirit to receive your gift of forgiveness and to be forgivers as well. As we come before you, God, we lay at your feet those burdens, those concerns that are too heavy for us to speak and to bear alone. Hear us in the prayer, in our silent prayers. Loving God, we have prayed to those things that concern us. Now we bring before you our joys, that you may rejoice in what it is that we have done well and celebrate, and that you help us, that you may help us to continue to celebrate and to enjoy you through our acts and through our lives. Hear our silent prayers. God, you have heard our spoken and our silent prayers, and we bring them before you in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. I don't think we have any customers for Anna this morning. So I'm going to invite Kathy to share our scripture with us.
The first reading is from Colossians
1,
verses
1
to 17. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to be to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And the second reading is 1 Corinthians 11:23 to 26. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Thank you, Kathy. And we just want to welcome Kathy for the praise team as well. And then we're going to sing that. Thank you.
There we go.
Trying to save paper, so I'm printing them on both sides of the sheet, but sometimes it makes it a little more confusing. So today, you heard Daryl play Over the Rainbow as an offering, solo guitar piece. Have you ever heard it with the words before? Mm-hmm. Done by Judy Garland, right? Mm-hmm. Have you ever sung Happy Birthday before today? We do it a little bit differently, don't we? One of the things about music is that you can play with it. You can use it in different ways. You can adjust the melody, you can adjust the rhythm, you can speed it up, slow it down, add instruments, take away instruments. There's nothing like Amazing Grace done with the bagpipes and a strong choir. But once at a funeral, I heard it, we did it on the organ, or the organist played it, and not only did she do it on this mighty Wurlitzer with 1,000 pipes, every verse, for those of you who play music, this might make a little more sense, but every verse she changed key. Every verse she changed key. So it gave a very different mood to the 5 verses that we sing. And then by the time we got to the 5th verse, she brought it back to the home key. But it was so powerful to have those little interludes where she changed and you weren't quite sure where she was going, and then she landed on these new notes and we sang them. So you can do these variations. You can play with things a little bit. You can do it in life as well. You know, take a look at folks' clothing. Have you ever worn a tuxedo, gentlemen? And you've gone from, if you wore a tuxedo in the 70s, it was not black. Chances are it was not satin, it was velvet. And it was quite possible that you could have landed small aircraft on the lapels, right? Because they went from here just about to your shoulders. The latest style seems to have gone the other way, you know, black, very tight-fitting tuxedos with very narrow lapels and, you know, the standard black bow tie, but you can play with these things a little bit. Now, World Communion Sunday is a day when we celebrate communion, but we also, if we're going to be honest, we have to remember that when Jesus talked about communion, when Kathy read from the letter to the Corinthians today about communion, communion is one of those things that is laid down in law, but has not been so fixed that there is a single right way to do it. Now, Peter is going to follow along with me here, so I'll bring him back up. Put up the first slide, please. So this is what is said. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body," etc., etc. Go to the next slide. Now you see, here are the key confusing elements. It says he took bread, and then that bread, he said, "This is my body." Then he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood." So here we begin a little controversy, and one that was brought to a head in the Reformation because there were two camps. One camp, Martin Luther, believed very strongly in these phrases, "This is my body," so that when we take bread, Martin Luther believes that it is transubstantiated. That means that it changes from bread into the actual skin, bone, tendons, blood, internal organs of Jesus. Okay, that it is an actual physical presence of Jesus in the bread. And that the wine is actually no longer wine, but is blood. That's because of what it says there. Took bread, this is my body, this cup, my blood. Go to the next slide, however. Look what happens here, though. there's these words added, in remembrance of me, in remembrance of me. So some folks said, well, no, Luther, you're off the mark. This is just a memorial. This is a symbol. It's not really the bread, or it's not really the body and the blood of Christ. It's just a symbol. And you would think that grown adults could get along and say, well, you know what, Daryl, you believe that it's a symbol, I believe that it's the body, but we can agree to disagree. But no! No, not even, you know, you say, well, back in the old day, they were a lot smarter than we were. No! They were just as stubborn and sometimes dumb as we are. So, Martin Luther in one camp and Huldrych Zwingli in the other camp are fighting it out in the middle of the Reformation. While they're trying to establish some changes, here we have some fighters within the group. It's kind of ridiculous. So today's hero was a man named Martin Bucer. And Bucer had a beautiful heart. Bucer couldn't understand the need for this controversy. He couldn't understand why people were arguing so much about these things. And so he tried to bring things together. Martin Bucer was a German priest who was actually able to meet Martin Luther. So he started out in the Roman Church, but when he met Martin Luther, he was converted to the Reform side, saw what Luther had to say, realized what the church was doing, the Roman Church was doing, and came over to the Reform side, but he could never agree with Luther on this idea of the bread and of the blood. He thought that, okay, fine, that's what you think, Luther, but you know what, I agree with Zwingli, but here's the thing, I'm not going to fight it with you. In fact, Bucer's career was marked not only by trying to not ruffle feathers, but actually trying to bring folks together, trying to find wordings in the declarations of the Reformed Church that would be a compromise, that would allow room for Martin Luther's followers and Zwingli's followers to say, hey, we can have our differences, but we agree on these common threads. And in fact, Bucer didn't stop there. Bucer also worked within the Reformation with folks like Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor, to try to find ways that the Roman Church and the Reformed Church could exist alongside. Can you imagine that? Somebody actually working to compromise? Somebody actually open-minded enough to say, you know, I really don't like wearing suits. I would much rather wear comfortable pants and a sweater. But if you want me to wear a suit on certain occasions, I will. So that's what this gentleman was doing. That's what Bucer was doing. He was trying to bring about this compromise, these agreements. And his thought was, there is no point in trying to agree in Christians. He actually wrote in a letter once that he realizes that no two Christians see things alike. Ever. I'll bet you, within our church here, there are folks who have different opinions about things. You think so? I bet you if you look to your neighbor and you were to start talking politics, we could start fights. Fashion, musical tastes, religion, sports. How many here are Jays fans? How many here are Tigers fans? How many here couldn't care less? So you see, we have three opinions. Go to the next slide, please. This is what Jesus says. And this is what Bucer's heart was. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all in all. Now here, Paul is talking about the divisions between Christians, saying you're still remembering your roots. You're remembering where you're from. You're remembering whether you came from the Jewish side or whether you came from Rome as a Gentile. You're remembering whether or not you are a master or your slave. And he says, that doesn't matter. What matters is that now you are a new thing in Jesus and you find unity in him. And then he goes on. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Human traits that we can achieve that have nothing to do with our race, our sports preference, where we were born, what we wear, the music we listen to. These are characteristics of the risen Christ that we are to take on. He then goes on. He says, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And there is the heart of why Jesus came. There is the heart of this meal. We gather here for this communion, not because we like pita, not because we like a shot of wine or grape juice, you have the option, not because you happen to like the odd formal meal, not because you want me to stand here and serve you and say it's about time he does something practical. That's not why we're here. We are here today to remember that Jesus died to forgive us, that Jesus gave his life so that we might live, and so that through us, Jesus does indeed live in the community and work and pray and feed others. And today, this special day started around 1930 by a Presbyterian minister in the United States, is a day when we remember as Christians throughout the world in commonality, our commonality, what we share together, and that is Christ. And here's the final statement that we take out of the scripture. Over all of these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. So let's say that you are a church in South Africa of 30,000 for whom worship consists of 3 to 4 hours of messages and singing. We are in perfect unity with that church, with that small country church where maybe you've got 8 people on a Sunday that's part of a 6-point charge that only gets there every 2 weeks. That has a rinky-dink organ that has to be pumped by feet. Have you ever seen the harmoniums? Of which only 3 keys are in tune. But the people there have a huge heart for the Lord, and they have a Sunday or a Saturday morning breakfast that feeds the community. We are in unity with our Nazarene brethren, we are in unity with the Baptists, with the United Church, with all of the denominations. So maybe we can go back to that first statement and rewrite it. Next slide, please. Maybe we can write it and we can say, here there is no Presbyterian or Nazarene, Baptist or Christian, Reformed, United Brethren, Pentecostal or Anglican, but Christ is all and is in all. Christ is all. That's why we are here. Christ is in all. He is within us. That's why we're here. Today we celebrate our unity, our uniqueness, our Savior. Amen. Now I'm going to invite you to share along with me. There's a fair bit of participation in this morning's liturgy. So you get the part that's bold and italicized. I get the little skinny part. So share with me the invitation to the table. Welcome, you who are spiritually hungry and thirsty.
Welcome, you who are lost and lonely.
Welcome, you who are searching.
Welcome, you who are in need of transformation and reformation.
Welcome, fellow children of God.
Welcome, fellow brothers and sisters in Christ.
Welcome, all who belong to the family called St. James Presbyterian Church.
Welcome, you who are guests from any other of Christ's churches. Welcome, God, for you have offered yourself through Jesus, your own Son.
And let's offer a sign of welcome to one another with a kind gesture or a loving word.
Good morning.
Back up. Let's pray. God, as we prepare and set the communion table, help us make it holy and beautiful in your sight. And as we get ready to do our jobs or to share your bread and wine, let your Spirit flow over us and through each of us. We pray together. Help us see each other as brothers and sisters in Jesus. Help us hear your voice answering our prayers. Help us understand what is happening. Help us to be renewed, reformed, and transformed. Help us to receive and to share your great love. Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, took bread. Having given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this to remember me." And after supper, he did the same thing with the cup, saying, "This cup is my blood, my new covenant with you. Each time you drink this cup, remember me." What you must solemnly realize is that every time you eat this bread and every time you drink this cup, you reenact in your words and actions the death of the Master. You will be drawn back to this meal again and again until the Master returns. Heavenly Father, as we have prepared our hearts, we now prepare the elements Christ offered us by taking ordinary bread and wine and asking that you help us to understand them in a new way. Bless the bread as a sacred offering, a sign of Jesus' body, broken for us so that we might be freed from sin. Sanctify the wine as a holy gift, a sign of Jesus' blood, shed for us so that we might know a new relationship with you, one in which we are no longer unworthy strangers, but beloved, wanted, and expected children, brothers and sisters to Christ and to one another. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we are gathered round this holy table. Receive Jesus' body broken for you. Receive Jesus' blood shed on your behalf. Thank you, God, for sending us your Son. Thank you, Jesus, for what you have done for us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for making this humble meal a sacred blessing. Kathy, can you do me a huge favor, please? Can you bring me a small cup from the bathroom of our overfilled communion chalice? Perhaps a little extra cup, too. So here's what's going to happen. Once I've straightened out my mistake, I'm going to invite you to come forward. There are going to be two lines. The one on my left is going to have grape juice, for those of you who prefer the grape juice, and the one to my right will have the wine, once I fix my mess, and you will come, you will receive a piece of pita, and so now I just need a couple of helpers. Kathy, can you help with me? It's all working out. I will give you bread. And I need one just to hold the grape juice. And I'm just going to invite you to come forward. So you will take a piece of the pita and dip it in the wine and then return to your seats or in the grape juice. the body of bread of Christ, the body and blood of Christ, broken for you, my friends. Now I'm going to invite you to stand if you're comfortable doing so as we conclude our final prayer and benediction. Let's pray together. Thank you, God, for this simple meal that reveals your great mercy, for hope renewed in forgiveness, for bodies, minds, and souls reformed by your Holy Spirit, for love expressed in giving and sharing, and for being but one of many churches throughout the world, separated by distance, but united in heart. As we all share this blessed feast today, let us take what we have received and live out our blessing, revealing mercy through gentle acts of kindness, renewing hope through bold acts of forgiveness, reforming our community and the world in which we live, united with Christian brothers and sisters around the entire globe, expressing love in selfless acts of giving and sharing. Let us do so in the name of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Now for our blessing, I'm just going to invite, if you can keep one eye on the screen and one eye on your neighbor and share this blessing with them. May wisdom guide your actions. May peace guide your hands. May love rule your heart. And may Christ consume your life, a new creation, blessed for blessing, his faithful servant in a reign without end. Amen. We're going to sing.
I sing.